الله رسول الله حبيب الله الله our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد My dear brothers and sisters, welcome to another edition of your program, Gardens of the Pious. Today's episode, by the grace of Allah, is number 281 in the blessed series of Riyadh al-Salihin. And it is the fourth episode in explaining chapter number 68, the chapter which is known as Al-Wara' wa Tarku al-Shubuhat. And without any further ado, the first hadith in today's episode is actually hadith number 594. This hadith is a sound hadith. It is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, may Allah have mercy on him, and it is narrated by Nafi'. أَنَّ عُمَرَ بْنَ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ كَانَ فَرَضَ لِلْمُهَاجِرِينَ الْأَوَّلِينَ 4,000 وَفَرَضَ لِابْنِهِ 3,500 فَقِيلَ لَهُ هُوَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ فَلِمَ نَقَصْتَهُ فقال إنما هاجر به أبوه يقول ليس كمن هاجر بنفسه رواه الإمام البخاري نافع may Allah be pleased with him مولى عمر narrated that عمر ابن الخطاب may Allah be pleased with him fixed the payment amounting to 4,000 dirhams for each one of the early مهاجرين immigrants But as for his son, he appointed for him 3,500 only. He was asked, but he's also an early muhajir, an early immigrant. Why did you fix a lesser sum for him? He said, it was his father who took him along with him. He is not like one who immigrated by himself. May Allah be pleased with Umar ibn al-Khattab and all the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hadith is collected by Imam al-Bukhari. It happened when Umar ibn al-Khattab was the caliph and with the expansion of the Muslim state and a lot of revenue was coming to Baytu Mal al-Muslimin. So they fixed like a monthly amount, salaries, for the early muhajirin versus those who immigrated late and for al-ansar. I mean, each one of the ummah used to have an income from baytu mal al-muslimin. But the early immigrants used to have a greater share because of their sacrifices, because of their support to the mission from its beginning and so on. So anyway, Umar ibn Khattab fixed the amount of 4,000 dirham per each person who immigrated earlier. When it came to his son, he fixed him the sum of 3,500 only, like, you know, 500 lesser than others. It wasn't his son who argued with him. It wasn't his son who said, why don't you give me like anybody else? Rather, the companions said, why don't you give him like everybody else? And he's your son. He said, that is why. Because he did not immigrate by himself. He is not the one who encountered the cost and the hardship of planning for the immigration. He immigrated with me. He was taba'un li. He was following me. So out of piety, out of fear that he may have given him something which he does not deserve, He reduced his salary, he reduced his income from Baytu Mal al-Muslimin 500 lesser than others. He said, إِنَّمَا هَاجَرَ بِهِ أَبُوهُ Yes, it is true that he was one of the early immigrants, but he did not immigrate by himself. It was his father who immigrated with him. He brought him with him to Al-Madinah. So that's why I give him a lesser amount. His father is Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu. It was the wara which made those companions afraid to touch or to go near anything which may not be lawful for them, even though it was the companions who argued with Umar ibn al-Khattab that he should receive a full salary like everybody else. Also, you call here when Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, and we have spoken about him before repeatedly. He is not an ordinary companion. He is one of the great companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is very knowledgeable. He is very wise, and subhanallah, he imitated the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all his traditions. Peace be upon him. So when Umar ibn al-Khattab became the caliph, and he appointed Usama ibn Zayd ibn Haritha. Usama ibn Zayd is known as Hibbu Rasulillah wa ibn Hibbi Rasulillah. Zayd ibn Haritha, Usama's father, was the Prophet's slave before Islam. And before Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam freed him and he adopted him and he gave him his last name. So he was known as Zayd ibn Muhammad. We all know this story. Then how adoption was obligated to only looking after orphans, but you do not give them your name. So he was loved so much by the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and similarly his son, Usama ibn Zayd ibn Haritha, and that's why he was known as Hibbu Rasulillah. Hib is from Mahabba, from love. And Ibn Hibbi Rasulillah, and the son of the one who was loved most by the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him. So during the Khilafah of Umar ibn al-Khattab, he used to give preference to Usama over his own son as far as the grants, as far as appointing him to a certain post, to a certain task, to be the governor of whatever. So Umar ibn al-Khattab was the Khalifa. He has the right to choose whomever he likes for any post and to decide any decision, and he's a just ruler. His son, Abdullah ibn Umar, said, "My dear father, I have noticed that you give preference to Usama over me, and I'm your son." He said, "Yes, indeed." He didn't deny that. He didn't say, "No, no, these are all frustrations and whispers of Satan." He said, "No, yes, indeed." He said, "The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved his father more than he loved your father. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, loved him more than he loved you. Why shall I not give preference to the Prophet's love over my own love? Yes, I love you more than anyone else. But when it comes to comparing between those whom Allah and His Messenger loved more, I love them more. More than you. You're my son. I love you so much. But I give preference to the Prophet's love over my own love." Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah be pleased with all the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it wasn't really a point of argument. It wasn't a big deal, because he provided a justification. In the case of giving him a lesser grant, he said because he didn't immigrate by himself. His father immigrated with him. He took him with him. And in the case of giving preference to Usama, because the Prophet loved Usama more than you, so I love Usama more than you. And I give preference to Usama over you. You are my own son, but I love Usama more because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to love him more. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a very high level of piety, brothers and sisters, to truly keep distance from anything which is mere dislike or can have the least doubt out of fear that you may indulge into what is forbidden. The following hadith, and it is also the last hadith in this wonderful chapter, the chapter of Al-Wara and Tarku Shubuhat, Al-Wara and abandoning the doubtful matters, is hadith number 595. And the hadith is narrated by Atiyah ibn Urwa al-Sa'di, may Allah be pleased with him. قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يبلغ العبد أن يكون من المتقين حتى يدع ما لا بأس به حذرا مما به بأس. Which means that none will attain complete piety until he abandons certain lawful but maybe doubtful matters, so as to remain on his guard against something which is objectionable. This is really something that most of us do not do. And I want to tell you before we elaborate on this hadith that this is a weak hadith. So while we're studying it, we're studying the hadith, number one, to alert the audience to its weakness. And number two, to understand a segment of Al-Wara, which is the hadith is listed in this chapter by Imam al-Nawawi for this reason. So if it was something mandating what to do and forbidding something not to do, we would say this is a weak hadith. But because it is in the area of righteousness and piety, he's talking about the perfect piety is to sometimes leave and abandon things which are not objectionable out of fear that it may be objectionable or it may lead you to what is doubtful. Yani, if you remember in the beginning of the chapter, we discussed how Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, found a date fruit. And he picked it up, then he said, if I was not afraid that it could be from the days of the charity, I would have eaten it. He wants to eat it. And it is a date, it is something insignificant. I mean, if somebody dropped a few dates, he would not go back to look for them. But since I'm not sure, it could be one of the dates of a sadaqah, I'm not going to taste it. Why not? Because the Prophet ﷺ said that we, the Prophets, do not eat the charity. We accept the gift, but we do not eat the charity. And this is how Salman al-Farisi verified that Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last messenger of Allah, since he accompanied monks, priests, and religious scholars of the people of the book in his journey for searching for the truth. He came to form an idea and a complete prophecy, the complete signs of the prophet whom they prophesied that he will emerge from this city which is full of the palm trees by the end of time. So anyway, talking about the charity and talking about the gift, I just remembered something here relating to Al-Wara. When Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, may Allah be pleased with him, received the gift, he returned the gift to the person who gave him the gift nicely. He admired him and he thanked him so much, and he said to his servant, go back, thank him so much, and say, I won't be able to accept it. So he said, that's your cousin, and it's a gift. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to accept the gift. True, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to accept the gift. And when Salman al-Farisi brought him the first day some dates and in Nakashif, and he opened it up and he said, eat, you and your friends, that's a charity. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam invited his companion and said, Bismillah, you eat, and he didn't touch it. The following day, Salman al-Farisi brought another nakshif full of dates, and he placed it before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was sitting with his companions and said, this is a gift for you and your companions. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, invited his companions and said, Bismillah, eat, and he stretched out his hand and he started eating with them. So a Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to accept the gift. A woman gave him a clock and he accepted it. Somebody gave him this and he accepted it. And in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, tahadu tahabu, exchange gifts, since that develops love. You would love one another when you exchange gifts. It is a sunnah, it is recommended, whether some perfume, some musk, some fragrance, or a thawb, clothes, everyone with their capacity. You can afford to give jewelry, fine. Exchange gifts since it developed love. But Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz refused to accept the gift. So when he was told, it's a gift, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to accept the gift, it's a sunnah, and it is from your cousin. So he said, Waihuk, woe to you. Whenever the gift was given to the Prophet sallallahu, it was perceived as a gift. But nowadays, and to a person like me, it may be perceived as a bribery. He's not certain that it is a bribery, but it may be perceived as a bribery. Why are you giving the Khalifa a gift? Do you need a permit to get a property or to occupy an area or to erect a building without a permit or to do anything that needs a permit, and you have connections with the president, with the ruler? You know somebody who is the son of the big officer and the cousin of the wife of the minister, so you get a signature, you get an approval because you are relating to him, or you are related to him, or because you visit and you exchange gifts. He said no. So whenever he was the Khalifa, he refused to accept gifts. That's called wara, because if he accepted it and it is a gift, and he is certain that he is not going to give anyone anything extra more than his right, even if he was his cousin, even if he gave him plenty of gifts, but he said, I don't want it. Wara, that's called wara. I don't want to mess up my page. I'm in a charge. I'm responsible for a big responsibility. So he says to his servant, Wai hulak, woe to you. Whenever that was given to the Prophet ﷺ, it was a gift. But to us, it may be perceived as a bribery or a rishwa. Why not? It was Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, may Allah be pleased with him, whenever he was sitting in his majlis, and this athar is narrated by Malik ibn Anas, may Allah be pleased with him. Malik ibn Anas, the great imam. He said, Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, while he was sitting in his majlis, they brought him some flasks of musk and ambar from Bayt Mal al-Muslimin to check it out, that we've received this. Some people, the merchants of perfumes and fragrance, they give donations so that it can be sold and they can benefit out of its price, or they can distribute it amongst the recipients. So amongst the gifts, it was a big one, which is full, big flask full of ambar and musk. When they opened it up, he plugged up his nose. Why did he plug his nostrils? They asked him, his julasa, his courtiers, said, why? He said, why hook? What is the benefit of the fragrance or the perfume? Is it anything other than the fragrance, the smell? And it's not mine. It belongs to Bayt Mal al-Muslimin. It belongs to the public fund of Muslims. So how can I benefit personally from something which is not for me? It belongs to others. That is called wara. That is called perfect piety and righteousness. May Allah be pleased with Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz and also with all the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If this is the case, brothers and sisters, then we need to reassess ourselves and our dealings. Sometimes you're working in an office, you have a copy machine and you have accessories and you have things which are basically for your work, office job. Doing anything which is personal on that, printing papers and documents for yourself, for your son, for your daughter, for their classes, so you are actually utilizing what is meant to be only for the job, for your employer, or if you're working for the government, so it's a public fund. And wallahi, it is very problematic. Allah the Almighty said, وَمَنْ يَغْلُلْ يَأْتِ بِمَا غَلَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. It's just some copy papers, man. My son wants to some sketch paper or some, so you take a pack of copy paper. Nobody's going to ask you because it's insignificant. That's called غُلُول, stealing from the public fund. whether you are a little employee, the coffee man, taking some sugar, some coffee, which is intended to be for the work, or you are the boss and you take things with you. The job, the work, appointed a car and a driver for you to pick you up from your job and to drop you off to your home or vice versa. Only that. And if you're doing work outside the office, you will be in your service. But this car and this driver is not meant to serve your wife. It's not meant to drop your mother-in-law to another city. It's not meant to drop your kids to the school in order to save the school bus. It's not meant to utilize them for anything which is personal. But you do. Why? Because no one is going to ask you. That is haram. This is not, we're not talking about wara. We're not talking about perfect piety and righteousness. We're talking about what is legal and what is not legal. Nowadays, in most businesses, government businesses, to get a certificate, to get a driver's license, to get an ID, in most cases, if you don't pay a bribe, you won't get your paperwork done. A day, two, three, four, and five, you've been going back and forth, you keep trying. If you don't stuff the $20 bill beneath your paperwork, it won't finish. You won't finish your paperwork. What is this called? The Prophet predicted that, and he said that people will call the haram different names, would call in what is forbidden different names, would change its nature. When you call black and white, when you call beer or alcohol, when you call it spiritual drinks, would that change its nature? Would that change the fact that it is forbidden and it is intoxicant? When you call heroin, opium, morphine, when you call that drugs, drugs also cover drugs which are used for medications. Okay. Would that change its forbidden nature? No, it won't. When you give this money in order to finish your paperwork and skip the line, would that change its nature and it will not be recognized as bribery? No, it is, even if you give it a different name. May Allah the Almighty guide us to what is best. Brothers and sisters, we'll take a short break and we'll be back inshallah in a few minutes to discuss some more on Al-Wara, then to begin a new chapter inshallah. Until then, please stay tuned. رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. We've been talking about الورع وترك الشبهات, piety and righteousness, and abandoning the doubtful matters, and we give a few examples. We discussed the wara of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, may Allah be pleased with him. And when we speak about this kind of generation, whether the companions or at-tabi'een or tabi'a at-tabi'een, doesn't mean that afterward the ummah doesn't have many more examples, but they're everywhere, even in today's world, alhamdulillah. It is simply we're providing examples in order to follow them, in order to imitate them. Sufyan al-Thawri, may Allah be pleased with him, he is considered one of the greatest scholars. At his time, he was known as Shaykh al-Islam. We're all familiar with the four schools of thoughts, Imam Abu Hanifa, the Hanafi Madhab, Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Malik, before Imam al-Shafi'i, then Imam Shafi'i and his madhab, the Shafi'i madhab, then Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and his Hanbali madhab. But also Imam Sufyan al-Thawri used to have his madhab, and he was a great faqih and a great scholar and a great scholar of hadith and a great mufti. During his time when the Khalifa Abu Ja'far al-Mansur first requested Abu Hanifa to be the chief judge, Abu Hanifa refused. That's wara. He doesn't want to indulge into trials. He said the Khalifa would order somebody to be executed and I just need to put my stamp and I will be responsible. No, I don't want to. So as a result of that, he was banned from giving the dars, he was banned from teaching, and he was furthermore imprisoned. And he died in his imprisonment during the era of the Khilafah of Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. So after Abu Hanifa rahimahullah died, Abu Ja'far al-Mansur looked and he asked, who is the most knowledgeable person and who is the most qualified person? They said, Sufyan al-Thawri. He ordered that Sufyan al-Thawri should be brought before him, and he said he appointed him to be the judge or the chief judge. Sufyan al-Thawri refused. He said, one, he said, I'm not qualified, and he pretended to be insane. So the Khalifa said, you're a liar. He said, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, and how could you appoint a liar to be the judge or the chief judge? You know, if you know that I'm a liar, how could you appoint me to be the chief judge? So he ordered that if he doesn't accept the post, he should be executed. When Abu Sufyan al-Thawri, may Allah be pleased with him, realized that it's a matter of life and death, he said, okay, no problem. Then he skipped. Once he left the palace, he skipped. That was in Al-Kufa, where the Khalifa was residing at. So he ran off and he went to Al-Basra. Both are in Iraq. And he ended up running out of fund because all the money that he had was gone. He doesn't have anything to even buy food, so he hired himself as a gardener. He worked for somebody as a gardener. The great imam, the great scholar, Sufyan al-Thawri, ended up working as a gardener. And when it was time to harvest the dates, the garden was full of date palm trees, and it was time to harvest the dates, the governors, they send al-ushar, those guys who go in order to estimate how much is it, and they take one-tenth as a zakah because it was watered through the rain. So when the person who came in order to collect one-tenth of the harvest of the rutab, of the ripe dates, he asked the gardener, who happened to be Sufyan al-Thawri, and nobody knows, he's concealed his identity. So he said, أرطب البصرة أفضل أم رطب الكوفة? He said, what do you think? Which rutab, which ripe dates taste better and sweeter? Al-Kufa or Al-Basra? So he said, as far as for Al-Kufa, I'm familiar with it. I know its dates, but I don't know about Al-Basra. He said, you're a liar, because you're working in the bustan, in the garden, and for months you've been working here. And he said, there is not a single person in Al-Basra, barrun or fajr, not even the dogs, whether a righteous person or a wicked person, even the dogs, the animals, eat from the dates of Al-Basra. Nowadays, it is the time of the harvest. The dates are everywhere. Are you trying and you're pretending to be so pious? You're telling me that you did not even taste the garden, the fruits of the garden, which you are its gardener? He said, I swear to Allah, I did not even taste it. So the person, the officer who's in charge of collecting the tenth, he went back to his manager and he shared with him the story of this person whom he thought he's a foolish person. He said, are you sure of what you're saying? He said, yes. He said, if this is true, then this person must be Sufyan al-Thawri. No one else would behave like that but Sufyan al-Thawri. You better go and you report him, because there is a big bounty over his head for whoever will bring him or tell on him where is he hiding. Sufyan al-Thawri figured out that people would chase him, so he left. The first incident here is also narrated by many narrators, including Al-Imam al-Zahabi in Siyar A'lam al-Nubala, in his collection of the Sirah and the biography of the very noble persons, scholars, and righteous people. Then he fled to Yemen, then from Yemen he fled to Mecca, and everywhere he goes, Al-Khalifa Abu Ja'far al-Mansur orders his governors to chase him, to arrest him, and finally in Mecca, subhanallah, when he was there, the Khalifa decided to go and perform Hajj, and it was during that year. When he was told that Sufyan al-Thawri is actually in the province of Mecca, He ordered the governor that he should search for him, he should arrest him, and he should be executed because he disobeyed the Khalifa and he ran away from him. So Sufyan al-Thawri ran to the Kaaba. He clinged his body against the Kaaba and he hung onto the cloth of the Kaaba and he begged Allah and he said, "Oh Allah, do not let Al-Mansur enter Mecca. Do not let Al-Mansur enter Mecca," Al-Khalifa Abu Ja'far al-Mansur. Subhanallah, that when he was traveling in the caravan to perform Hajj, right before entering Mecca, he got very sick and he died, and Sufyan al-Thawri was saved. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave an advice to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, very valuable advice. When he came to him and said, "Ya Rasulullah, ud'u Allah an yaj'alani mustajab al-da'wa. Ask Allah to make my prayer always answered and accepted." And Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, as you all know, is one of the 10 heaven bound companions, and he is the Prophet's cousin, and from another direction he's considered to be his uncle too. So he is a family member of the Prophet. He's a righteous person, righteous companion, and he's the only companion whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as they say, fadahu bi abihi wa ummi. The only person whom the Prophet ﷺ said, "Fidaka abi wa ummi tu," my mother and my father are sacrificed for you. That was on the Battle of Uhud when he said, "Irmi fidaka abi wa ummi," because Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas was a great archer. So with all these virtues of this great companion, he's asking the Prophet ﷺ to ask Allah to make Sa'd's dua accepted all the time. He said, "Ya Sa'd, atib mat'amaka takum mustajab al-da'wa." You want your dua to be accepted? Simply eat from halal. Make sure that what you introduce to your mouth and what you admit to your stomach is earned lawfully. Then your dua will be accepted. You don't need any dua from anyone. Atib mat'amaka takum mustajab al-da'wa. This is as the English say that, teach me fishing better than giving me a fish. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not only advise Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and he's only one of the 10 heaven bound companions. He's saved. He's living, walking on earth, and he knows that inshallah he's entering paradise. But the advice has a broader spectrum to cover the entire ummah. You, the viewers, myself, everyone, if you want your dua to be accepted, make sure that you eat from halal. When we end up eating from haram, that blocks our dua from being accepted. Now we are not talking about al-wara, leaving distance between you and the haram. We're talking about, please abstain from the haram, because it has become so common, so widespread. You know what? When you go to your job and you just sign in and you leave, or you ask your friend to sign out for you while you're gone, long time ago, the time that you did not appear at work, you did not actually work, you did not do your job, then by the end of the month you got your paycheck, a part of this earning is haram. As one of my students, when he graduated from a medical school, he was in his residency and they pay him very little. So he asked me that, "Is it okay if I don't go?" I said, "If you don't go, then you don't get paid." He said, "It's something very insignificant." I said, "You don't get paid. And you don't get your residency, because this is how you get trained and this is how you be qualified." He said, "But I go and I work outside and I make very good earning." I said, "Then don't accept the job. Don't accept the salary that they give you." He said, "Everybody does like that." So this is, it has become an excuse, but everybody does like that. It is so common in our countries. It is very unfortunate. A doctor, an engineer, a teacher, he doesn't show up at school. The class is full of students, 40, 50, sometimes 60 students in a classroom. Where is the teacher? He's gone. In my school, the teachers used to force us not to come. Why? Because if we show up, they have to show up too. So they don't want us to show up so that they can go and give private tutoring and they make money. Why? Because the job doesn't pay that much. Leave it. You signed a contract, you agreed to to this salary and you said you're happy with it, I know it is insufficient. I know that it is not the right salary, but leave it, leave the job. Work as a freelance. Be a private tutor. Why do you accept this? He wants some sum of security, so he wants to take a part of it and get the salary, and meanwhile gives nothing or gives just a little bit. He says this is what is sufficient for what they pay. This is how your income becomes unlawful. This is how your earning become unlawful. This is how you end up buying food out of this unlawful earning, and you feed yourself and your family from what is forbidden. We give many examples that somehow many of us are involved in unlawful earning because of that. May Allah the Almighty guide us to what is best. You may have heard about Yunus ibn Ubayd. May Allah be pleased with him, one of our great predecessors as well. And he was a merchant, and we spoke about the importance of being independent through being a merchant, through having some business that brings revenue for you, so you don't have to beg. You don't have to wait for people to give you money because you're leading the prayer or because you're giving the khutbah. And accordingly, you'll be extra cautious of what you're saying, not to displease, not to upset those who are paying you your wages and your salary. That has to be changed. Yunus ibn Ubayd was merchant. He used to sell fabrics like Imam Abu Hanifa. And this incident happened with him, and it happened with Imam Abu Hanifa. May Allah have mercy on all of them. A woman came to him with jubbatin min khaz, an outer garment of pure silk, very fine silk. And she said, I'm selling this. How much would you pay for it? He said, how much would you like to sell it for? She said, 500. He appraised it, and this is his business. He said, no, it's worth more. She said, 600, 700, 800. He said, 1,000, and he paid her 1,000. In the case of Imam Hanifa, the woman said to him that, are you mocking me? Are you making fun of me? He said, Ma'adallah, this is how much it's worth. So he paid extra, double or triple the price. Why? Because he knows this is how much it is. This is how much it's worth. And he's going to sell it for more than that. He's going to make a profit out of that. In another incident, again, Mutrafi Khazin, again, a fabric made of pure silk, somebody brought it to him to buy it, because this is what the merchants do. They buy and they sell. So he handed over to his neighbor. He said, how much do you think it's worth? The woman brought it to him, and she said, I need 60 dirham for that. He said, how much do you think it's worth? He said, this is like 120. So he said, would you sell it for 125? I'm buying it for 125. Who does like that nowadays? Who does so? Who? When you go to a doctor's clinic and somehow it is packed and people are standing. Why? Because the nurse accidentally made double booking. So he is supposed to check on 15 patients tonight. Now there are 30 or 35 people. It's impossible. If you're supposed to spend 10 minutes or 15 minutes or 20 minutes with each patient, now it's going to be only 5 minutes. Why? Because there's double booking. To be honest enough, you would come out and you say, I'm so sorry. Some of you would have to come back tomorrow. Or I would give you a break and come back tomorrow. Or those who would come tomorrow, I would give them 50% off because there is double booking. I would say, you know, no problem. And instead of giving 10, 15 minutes, it would be 5 minutes. And he would just quickly, oh, so what do you have? What do you complain of? And write down the prescription. You know, a doctor is not only supposed to diagnose the disease and write down the prescription, he's supposed to be hakim, supposed to be wise, he's supposed to be honest. He's supposed to see the patient before him. I'm not a social worker. Yes, you should be a social worker. Maybe this woman is a widow and the patient is an orphan. So no one is to buy the medication. And you've got a bunch of samples. The pharmaceutical companies are giving you a bunch of samples. Open the closet and say, ma'am, here's a medication in case that you need a refilling. But take this, that would be sufficient. How much is 75 bucks? No, but this is for free. He didn't pay for it, did you? He didn't. Those samples are supposed to be for the season. I know that you give it to your friends, your family members, and those whom you like. But wallahi, this woman and this patient are more worthy than anybody else. Because we all know that there are a lot of patients who cannot afford to buy the medication. So after they go to the doctor and they know what they have, they will go to the pharmacist and they say, okay, what is the alternative? This is a generic name. Is there anything cheaper? And it will be up to the pharmacist. Again, if he is honest, he may give her something similar to it, the same active ingredient, and a little cheaper. Okay? And this is possible. And you as a physician, you should have done that from the beginning. But many physicians, particularly in the Middle East, in the Gulf, in the Muslim countries, many of them, whenever they write the medication, they do not write the medication because this is the best medicine that treats this diagnosed disease. Many of them write the medication because the pharmaceutical company is monitoring the doctor. How many prescriptions, how many pack of this medication will he prescribe? And basically there will be, he calls it a gift, a trip to Europe, a brand new car, the new model, or you name it, they furnish his new clinic. Some actually doctors, they will buy them a clinic, you know. It varies. It's bribery. And the doctor who's prescribing this medication to the patient, because he knows that the company is monitoring his prescriptions and taking copies out of that, and he is waiting by the end of the year or by the end of the quarter to get his bonus with his commission, is a traitor, is a cheater. His earning is unlawful, and he is no physician. He's a thief, and he's no merciful man. He's not a hakim, he's not a wise man. He's a thief, he's a robber. But instead of robbing people on the highway, he is robbing people in his clinic. May Allah have mercy on us. This is just another example that we're talking about. So brothers and sisters, أطب مطعمك تكن مستجاب الدعوة. And if there is anything that there is the least doubt in it, just distance yourself from it. You will not lose much. من ترك شيئا لله أبدله الله خيرا منه. Whoever gives up and abandons anything for the sake of Allah, Allah the Almighty will give him better than what he lost. What he gave up on for his sake, what he abandoned for his sake, he didn't lose anything. It's all dunya. It's all insignificant. But you gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By that, we will wrap it up. And inshallah, in the next episode, we will begin the new chapter. So we will not scratch the surface of the new chapter today, inshallah, because we ran out of time. Until the next week, brothers and sisters, I leave you all in the care of Allah. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price. So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price.